And now we call for Dr. Karim Shalabi. Also don't speak about the MRI or support images of him.
Today I'm going to discuss MRI of the head. We are going to talk into a little bit details on pathologies other than the femoral standard vision. We are going to discuss the femoral standard attention, of course, but there are a lot of the head other than the femoral standard vision. We are going to discuss support. First, we are going to discuss the femoral standard engagement of the lumbar case. Second, the density around the head. And this will lead the scope on the greater to cantilever planes involved. Then, we are going to discuss the pathology of the different tendinous groups around the head, the sensus pubis, hip snapping, proximal hamstring attachment complex, the rectus femoris injuries, and lastly, the allergic injuries. There is another type of impingement called the ischial femoral impingement. Intra-articular pathology includes the ligamentum penis injuries. And lastly,
don't look this way. Okay. Concentrate on this thing.
Okay. And lastly, bone marrow edema around the head. First, labral tears and femoral stapler impingement. And in this slide, I would like to stress that labral tears do not occur only with impingement. Labral tears may occur due to trauma, or may occur in cases of dysplasia where there is hypertrophy of the labrum superior, and it may occur in cases of impingement. On the other hand, a patient with clinical features of impingement should not by default have labral tears, because the pain may occur due to condylar pathology. And the condylar pathology may be seen on conventional MR, like on proton density and the gradient images. However, recently one of our colleagues, Dr. Abdella, is here in the audience. He is working on advanced cartilage imaging and cartilage mapping. And we have seen that there are, in the papers he gave to us, that there are areas of contour, sometimes there may be contour injury seen on advanced imaging and not seen on conventional imaging. So a patient with femoral stapler impingement, clinically, by conventional MRI, it may be normal. So I would just like to stress that femoral stapler impingement may occur without labral tears, and labral tears may occur without femoral stapler impingement. The two different types of the femoral stapler impingement are the famous CAM type and pincer type. CAM refers to this shape, which is a kind of machinery that rotates, and with its rotation it causes friction at the surrounding structures. While this tool is what is called the pincer, and it tends to overcover or engulf certain structure. So the CAM type there is occurs at the femoral side of the hip joint, where there is abnormal shape, like the CAM machine. While pincer type occurs at the acetabular side, where there is overcoverage, and the acetabulum acts as a pincer to that against to the opposing structure. I would like to discuss briefly the anatomical variants of the hip. And I heard one of our professors, he had said that the labral pathology at the shoulder is difficult, and the labral pathologies at the hip are extremely difficult. And he gave two causes. The first is the extreme curvature of the hip. The hip has extreme curvature in three-dimensional fashion. And the second cause I'm going to discuss shortly. So first, this is what we call the stellate crease. The stellate crease is an area at the superior acetabulum that is normally devoid of coverage. It should not be mistaken for condylar defect. So if this patient comes with clinical presentation of femoral stapler impingement, we should not miss, even in a public clinical setting, this site is normally devoid of coverage. This is not convert effect. The second is the very labor recess. The very labor recess is the region, is the area between the joint capsule and the labor. And it contains joint flow. And it's, it occurs anywhere around the joint and it's easy to identify. The sublabor sulcus is easy to identify, and it is the space between the ligamentum teres and the labor. As opposite to the shoulder, the labor in the head is incomplete. Inferiorly, from 4 to 7 o'clock axis, the labor is incomplete and is substituted by the transverse acetabular ligament. So, the junction between the transverse acetabular ligament and the labor, they may be a sublabor sulcus. Okay, and it comes at specific location, which is the posterior region. This is the second cause for the complexity of the labor assessment of the labor. The sublabor recess. The sublabor recess is partial undercutting of fluid beneath the labor. And this, the problem is it can occur anywhere. In the shoulder, the variants occur mainly at the anterosuperior quadrant. However, in the hip, it may occur anywhere. So what helps to differentiate this from tear? First, the sublabor recess is partial and regular. There is no associated paralabor cysts, and the related cartilage is more or less normal. Okay? Regarding the mechanism of injury, the camp type of impingement, there is two mechanisms of injury. First is there is an abnormal osseous pump at the femoral neck junction. Okay, so this pump during flexion and the internal rotation will compress the anterosuperior labor, resulting in pain and impingement. The pump is seen at the femoral head neck junction, and the pump is seen lateral at the facial scar. The second cause of cap-type impingement is the gun-shaped deformity or pistol grip deformity, where there is loss of the waist, normal waist of the femoral neck. Okay? And similar pathology or similar mechanism occurs with this bony area impinges on the anterosuperior labor. This is the pistol grip deformity on X-ray and MRI, where there is loss of waist of the femoral neck. The pincer type impingement is the opposite. There it occurs on the acetabular side with acetabular femoral neck overcoverage. And we may see two entities. First is the coxa profunda. This is an area of camp impingement with femoral head pump at the femoral head neck junction. So it's normal, basically normal on the acetabular side. This is the medial acetabular wall and this is the iliofacial line. This is the normal relation. If the medial acetabular wall comes in medial to the iliofacial line, this is called coxa profunda. And it may be associated with pincer type impingement, but not necessary. It may be seen in normal patients, normal individuals. More severely, there is the protrusion acetabulum. The medial wall not only crosses the iliofacial line, but also crosses the iliopectineal line. The second cause of pincer type impingement is the acetabular retroversion. Acetabular retroversion means that the acetabular cup opens posteriorly. While the acetabulum normally is antiverted and the acetabular cup opens anteriorly or anterolaterally. So that the medial acetabular wall is the anterior acetabular wall is medial to the posterior wall. If this is reversed, impingement occurs, and this is called pincer type femoroacetabular impingement. This is an X-ray and CT for femoroacetabular impingement due to acetabular retroversion. Acetabular retroversion usually occurs at the superior aspect of the joint, while the inferior aspect of the joint is not anteverted. So, on an X-ray, there would be crossing of the anterior and posterior acetabular walls. what is called the figure of 8 sun. On CT, we see the standard cup opens slightly posteriorly and the anterior wall seen better to the posterior wall. So what are the findings of internal scapular impingement? In both types, we see lateral tail. The lateral tail usually occurs anterosuperiorly. This is an anterosuperior lateral tail. And the signal here extends along the whole length of the labor, so it is not considered a valid sublabor recession. And this is the area on the sagittal image. Some surgeons prefer that we use the clock face-wise for lateral tails. Here the labor is incomplete from 4 to 7 o'clock axes, where there is the transverse scapular ligament. And we use the rest of the block face. 3 block is anterior, whether it is right or left. And 9 block is posterior, and 12 is superior. So the lateral tails usually appear at 1 and 2 block axes. And remember, these are the lateral tails that are due to femoral scapular impingement, not due to trauma. The trauma can occur anywhere. The second is the presence of condylar injury. The condylar injury occurs anterosuperiorly adjacent to the labor pathology in CAM type, and it occurs on the opposite side as a proctor 2 effect posteriorly in tensor type impingement. We may see a bilabial cyst, and if you see a bilabial cyst, we are going to be sure about the signal that presents a tail rather than anatomical variant. Other possible findings in femoral scapular impingement is the presence of familial herniation pits at the anterior aspect of the femoral neck and laterally. It may occur in cases of impingement, however, it may occur in normal patients without impingement. So it is auxiliary feature and not main feature for femoral scapular impingement. The second is the os acetabular. The os acetabular is accessory ossification on the scapular ligament. Look at this. In this case, there is a large osseous structure at the anterolateral margin of the scapula. If it's not present, the scapula will be antivertebral. However, taking in consideration this osseous structure, the scapular cup will be retrovertebral. So, it will cause scapular impingement in a similar fashion to retroversion. When we report these cases, we should mention in cases of suspected femoral scapular impingement, we should do some measurements to verify our findings. Because in a coronal MRI or AP X-ray, the presence of the femoral head neck junction bump could be questionable. However, on axial oblique images, it may be easy to identify. This is a normal MRI of the head, and this is the femoral head. We do the best fit circuit of the femoral head and identify its center. Then, and we draw two lines. Line along the middle aspect of the femoral neck, parallel to its both anterior and posterior cortices. And the second line is a line that crosses line from the center of the femoral head to its periphery, crossing at the side where the head starts to change its direction. Here, the cortex follows the margin of this circuit. Once it leaves, so this is the point we use to measure the alpha angle. Here, the alpha angle increased due to the presence of femoral acetabular impingement due to osseous bump, and normally, because the alpha angle have valuable reports regarding its value, the alpha angle could be normal up to 55 or 60 degrees. But normally, the bump is visible to see even before measurement. So we should not rely solely on measuring. The bump is readily seen on MR sequence, axial or oblique image. The second is the femoral offset. The femoral offset, we use it to identify if there is distal great deformity. And it's measured as a distance between the anterior cortex of the femoral neck and the tangential to the most anterior aspect of the femoral neck. This distance should be more than 8 millimeters. If it is decreased, there is abnormal morphology of the femoral neck and blood vessels. So this is the positive grade control. This is for cases for the femoral side. For the scapular side, we should assess the scapular coverage. The scapular coverage of the femoral neck, we use the lateral central edge angle. Again, we measure the best fit circle of the femoral neck, and from its center, we draw two lines, line that is bent vertical, and a line that passes tangential to the outer lateral rim of the osseous scapula. And this range should be 20 to 40%. It's decreased in displacement, medial edge. It's increased in cases of over coverage. So over coverage with lateral central edge angle more than 40 degrees is suspicious of pincer type femoral scapular pain. And lastly, we should assess the scapular version. The scapular version is measured. This is CT in a pediatric patient. This is a line passing tangential through the ischial spine on both sides. And this is a line vertical to it. So the angle is the angle between this vertical line and the line tangential through the anterior and posterior walls of the scapula. Normally, the scapula is antiverted by 15 to 20 degrees in adults. Okay? So decreased version or even retroversion is associated with pincer type femoral scapular dysplasia. There is something that came to my knowledge recently, and some of the orthopedic surgeons at our faculty have been asking for, is that use of high resolution single dip MRI. The smaller field of view allows for better detailed assessment of both of each hip individually. Okay. And we basically use the same sequences as the routine MRI hip, but we add three sequences. First is the 3D gradient sequence, primarily acquired in the corner plane, for assessment of the labor. On the one side. The other sequence is T1 axial oblique, and it's used to measure the alpha angle. And the second is T1 axial on both hips, and this is used to assess the scapular version, because we need the other ischial spine for assessment. So this is basically the details of the femoral scapular impingement and the single hip MRI. The second term is the bursae around the hip. The bursae are normally located pouches that are collapsed during normal conditions, and it occurs around the joint that may be connected to the joint cavity. If there is inflammation, bursitis, there is fluid distension in this bursae. We have the greater bursae at the greater protractor, we have the iliopsoas bursa, and we have the ischial bursa. In the greater protractor bursae, there are three bursa. First is the subgluteus maximus bursa, and it's the main bursa, and it's the generic name for the greater protractor bursitis. And there are other two bursae, which are the subgluteus minimus bursa and subgluteus medius bursa. So it's basically bursa beneath every tendon. The iliopsoas bursitis, occurs medial to its fluid that is seen medial to the iliopsoas tendon, and it is normally connected to the joint tendon. So in cases of marked joint distension, the bursa will be distended as secondary decompression. So we won't call it bursitis unless there is disproportionate distension of the bursa as compared to the joint fluid. The iliopsoas bursa on sagittal image may mimic paralegal cyst. However, it does not extend to the labral margin. It is basically related to the iliopsoas bursa. The ischial bursa is fluid segment seems superficially to be the hamstring origin from the ischial tuberosity. And this is the same image of bone and pain. The great African Ferry person, these are there are much details to say about the greater full contact. First, the submedius maximus bursa, and it is beneath the medius maximus and the tibial band, and it is the mid bursa that is the standard here. And when we report greater full contact bursitis, we usually mean submedius maximus bursitis. There is also submedius medius bursa, which is localized with fluid related to the through the gluteus medius tendon, and there is also the subgluteus minimus bursa, and they occur mainly with tendon pathology. So this side, the greater tuberculator, we have what is called the greater tuberculator pacing bone, GTPS, and some authors have compared it to the rotator cuff of the shoulder with few differences that I'm going to mention. As for the greater and lesser tuberosities of the humerus, we have the greater and lesser tuberculator of the femur. The rotator cuff of the hip does not attach to the lesser tuberculator. The lesser tuberculator serves as an attachment to the usual tendon. However, the gluteus medius and minimus tendon attach to the greater tuberculator. The greater tuberculator has four facets. The anterior facet serves as an attachment for the gluteus minimus tendon. The posterior and the lateral facets serves as attachment for the gluteus medius, and the posterior facet is big and has no muscular attachments. So this is a normal anatomy. This is the gluteus minimus tendon attaching to the anterior facet of the greater tuberculator, and this is the gluteus medius tendon attaching to the posterior facet. And this is a coronal image. This is the gluteus medius attaching posterior, and the more anterior image you see the gluteus minimus. The first difference between the rotator cuff of the hip and that of the shoulder is the balance of bare area between the gluteus medius and the minimus tendons. With the exception in the shoulder, with the exception of the rotator vertebra, lateral to the level of the rotator vertebra, the rotator cuff is complete. It's a complete arc, muscular fibers from the subscapularis, suprascapularis, infrascapularis, and teres minor. However, with the gluteus medius and minimus, normally, there is a bare area between the two attachments. And the importance of this area is in cases of pathology, we should not overestimate or overread the extent of the tail. As any tendons, and as for the rotator cuffs of the shoulder, there could be tendinosis. Tendinosis, there is inflammation, tendon thickening, endogenous signal, related soft tissue edema with no tendon tears. We may have partial tears. This involves the gluteus minimus and medius tendons. This is the corresponding sagittal image. And we may have a complete tear. And the second difference between the rotator cuff of the hip and that of the shoulder is the tendon retraction. At the shoulder, the tendon retraction helps to define the tail, and the distance of retraction should be measured for the surgeon to assess surgical intervention. However, in the gluteal tendon tears, mainly the gluteus minimus tendon, there is no retraction due to tethering by the related upper part of the vastus lateralis muscle. So we may have complete tendon there and fluid fit together with no tendon retraction. Secondary sign for tendon pathology is the presence of incisive pipe. This is a bone graft at the anterior facet of the greater tuberculator. And some authors have suggested the figure of 2 millimeters, above which, if you see an X-ray or MR, we should suspect nuclear technology. Another sign is what we call the test drive sign. As for the shoulder, joint, the tendons, in cases of tears, there could be associated muscle atrophy, and is graded by the Dupuytren classification. However, the atrophy, the atrophy of the anterior part of the gluteus medius tendon may be an incidental finding without tendon tears. So, in cases of symptomatic gluteus minimus pathology, there is atrophy of the posterior part of the gluteus minimus tendon. So this is called the fat-stripe sign, which is cut between the normal anterior part of the gluteus minimus and the gluteus medius muscle tendons. So this is the greater rudimentary pain syndrome. The greater rudimentary pain syndrome, we may see findings of greater rudimentary pain syndrome, like stomach syndromosis or bursitis. However, some of the patients have these MRI findings without matching clinical symptoms. So there could be another cause of pain. And other causes of lateral hip pain include arthritis or femoral nerve irritation, or what I discussed tomorrow, the lateral prosthetica, the irritation of the lateral cutaneous nerve of the foot. The eosaurus bursitis and the greater rudimentary pain syndrome may be associated with hip snapping. Hip snapping or coxa saltans is is a clinical condition where there is audible, the patient can hear audible sound during flexion and extension. And the MRI findings are basically the same as the greater rudimentary pain syndrome and eosaurus bursitis. So it's basically a clinical diagnosis. There are three types: intra-articular, like because of presence of intra-articular loose bodies, external hip snapping occurs at the greater rotator, and internal hip snapping occurs at the near eminence and the eosaurus tendon. The pathology of the symphysis pubis, or what is called the sportsman tibia, and this is a misnomer because there is no actual variation of any soft tissue structure. So the better name is athletic rebungia. Athletic rebungia may occur at the bone, may occur at the tendineous structures, or may occur at the capsular structures. This is the normal anatomy of the tendons at the symphysis pubis, and the symphysis pubis serves as an attachment to follow the insertion of the rectus tendons and the origin of the adductor muscles. They are basically continuous. In osteitis pubis, we see marrow edema at the attachment site. So this is basically marrow edema without tendon pathology. The tendon tears may occur at the deep aspect of the tendon. And the third pathology is the presence of capsular tears. Tear of the capsule of the symphysis pubis. So this is a fluid signal due to the tendon tear. And there is another vertical fluid signal extending into the joint, and which is called the secondary left side. So in symphysis pubis, we have in the osteitis pubis, we have capsular tear in the secondary left side, or we have tendon, adductor tendon, tendinosis and pain. Then we're going to talk about the posterior group of the hip, which is the proximal hamstring attachment complex. The ischial tuberosity serves as an attachment for the hamstring muscles. In hamstring muscles, there are three hamstring muscles. We have the semitendinosus, and we have the semitendinosus and biceps tendinosus muscles. The semitendinosus muscle arises separately from the lateral facet, This is the superior aspect of the lateral facet of the ischial tuberosity. And medially, there is the conjoint canthal for both the semitendinosus and bisubsternal stem. This is the conjoint canthal. Okay, and this is the semi-inferiorous tendon arising laterally. Immediately, this is the conjoint tendon. In cases of proximal hamstring injury, it is very important to note that there is here, this is the hamstring attachment. This is the attachment for the adductor magnus muscle. So we should not mistake this part, adductor tendon, as a residual in cases of bone attachment origin, hamstring origin, you should not mistake this part as intact fibers of the hamstring origin. It's adductor area. And as any other muscle pathology, we have top three grades of injuries. Grade one injury of muscle strain, we may have febrile muscular edema, maybe epicenter of the myofibrillary junction. Grade two injury, there is partial thickness tear in the fiber interruption. And the grade 3 injury, like this photo, we have bare ischial tuberosity, there is no tendons. So this is full thickness tear with tendon retraction. The full thickness tear may occur at 3 categories. They may be tendon adduction from the bone, they may be tendon tear with another with a tendon stump attached to the bone, and this usually occurs in adults. However, in children, the tendon is not attached to bone, it's attached to cartilaginous apophysis. And the cartilaginous apophysis is weaker than the tendon, for the tibial side occurs usually at the apophysis. In adults, the tendon is the bone is usually stronger than the tendon, so the failure is tendinous. Okay, again, these are photos of full thickness tear of the hamstring origin with tendon retraction. We should measure the length of gap in cases of tendon retraction. And this, again, this is a midfoot. This is not a hamstring origin. This is part of the adductor tendon. For the anterior muscles of the thigh, the most common muscle to be injured is the rectus femoris injury. The rectus femoris has two heads. First, the direct head, which arises from the anterior inferior iliac spine, and the indirect head, which arises from the underlying acetabular. The tendon and the muscle has different relations according to the level. At the tendon, this diagram shows the relation between the muscle fibers and the tendons at different levels of the thigh. Superiorly, there is a labeling of muscle, and there is the direct head, and the indirect head is horizontal. And as we extend, the indirect head becomes vertical and perpendicular to the direct head. The direct head is planted with the anterior fascia of the thigh. So, the indirect head is most susceptible to pathology, so the edema will follow the appearance of the tendon. As this MRI, this is grade 1 muscle strain of the rectus femoris muscle. The edema is seen at the myofibrillary junction. And on axial image at the mid thigh, this is the tendon showing vertical orientation, and the muscle edema represented on the myofibrillary junction. This comes to the abduction injuries. Abduction injuries occur mainly at apophysis, because the apophysis is less strong than the tendon. It is usually preceded by, unless in cases of acute forcible muscle action, there is a abduction injury. However, in cases of overuse, and we have seen it a few times, MRI, there may be apophysitis only. And the patient show a high signal of the cartridge is basically high signal, but it's more hard when we compare it with other apophyses, and it shows increased growth signal. So this is apophysized, fraction apophysized. If the apophysis is separated, this is a vulvar injury or apophysiolysis. According to the site of attachment, as we all know, the tendon will tear certain apophyses, the sartorius, apophysis avulsion injuries at the anterior superior spine. These are both heads of the spinal muscle, as mentioned, the lesser trochanter, the ischial tendon, ischial tuberosity, for the hamstring origin. The area presses an attachment for many muscles in the simplest pubis attached, as we said, by the common adductor rectus spinalis tendons. These are MRI examples of avulsion injuries. This is avulsion, the ischial spine apophysis. This is avulsion of the iliac crest apophysis with related marrow edema and muscular edema. We have discussed the femoral assembly impingement or TAR. There is another cause of impingement, which is called the ischial femoral impingement. The ischial femoral impingement occurs when there is narrow distance between the lesser trochanter and the ischial tuberosity. And here, this is the quadratus femoris muscle. So when there is narrow, there should be muscular edema of the quadratus femoris muscle, which is the hallmark of this injury. The papers have certain cutoff values, 15 millimeter as cutoff value for the ischial femoral space, which is the space between the lesser tuberosity and the ischial spine, and the lesser trochanter, and the quadratus femoral space, which is the space between the lesser trochanter and the hamstring tendon, with cutoff values of 15 and 10 millimeters. So these are examples for ischial femoral impingement, where there is edema of the quadratus femoris muscle. And here, there is first approved connection, which could cause sciatic nerve irritation and sciatic alert symptoms. This is another ischial femoral impingement case. In chronic cases, there may be atrophy of the muscle, and there may be osseous hypertrophy of the greater trochanter, which adds more to the narrow hand impingement. Intra-articularly, there is the ligamentum teres. The ligamentum teres is attached to the this depression, the femoral head, which is called the fovea, fovea centralis. The femoral site is the site of pathology in the ligamentum teres, and as any tendon, there could be degeneration, partial tearing, or complete tearing. It may occur in cases of chronic and prolonged dislocation, as in cases of non-treated or DDH. And one of the signs for ligamentum teres is the presence of marrow edema at the medial aspect of the femoral head. So not every case of marrow edema is a case of a vascular necrosis, which this brings us to the last topic, which is the bone marrow edema pattern around the hip. First, the osteonecrosis. The second is the subchondral insufficiency fracture, transient osteoporosis of the hip. And these are the three things that we should differentiate. And there is another possibility, that is the infection, which I guess was extensively discussed by the faculty. First, the famous osteonecrosis. I'm not going to discuss in detail the osteonecrosis, but I'm going to stress how to differentiate these different entities. The osteonecrosis, there is at that point, there is the double line, the famous double line sign, or subchondral crescent, or subchondral fraction. And there should be marrow edema related to the femoral head, the viable bone. However, in cases of subchondral insufficiency fracture, there is also a subchondral line. However, the subchondral line here is stress related due to weight bearing, increased weight bearing, or overuse. The problem is there should be a difference in management. The patient with ADN, with early, they could benefit from drilling. However, in cases of subtotal insufficiency factor, they should benefit from rest and limitation of weight bearing. So the difference is, there are two differences that could differentiate a vascular necrosis from subtotal insufficiency factors. The subtotal present in osteonecrosis shows this curvilinear configuration that if extended to intersect the cortex at two different lines. However, the insufficiency fracture comes in a curvilinear fashion that is parallel to the cortical source. And another sign we have seen in clinical practice is the extent of maloedema in subcortical insufficiency fractures is far more wide than the osteonecrosis. So the extent of maloedema should not favor the osteonecrosis over insufficiency fracture. Lastly, transient osteoporosis of the hip. Transient osteoporosis of the hip. Some authors state that it is a subcondylar insufficiency fracture that we have not identified in MRI. And the differentiation is not that important because the management for insufficiency fractures and osteoporosis is basically rest and analgesia and non-surgery. But one of the clues that have been reported to confirm the diagnosis of transient osteoporosis of the hip, because it is overuse injury, is that sparing the body mechanics. There should be sparing of maloedema at the median femoral neck and at the radiator canal. So the word maloedema, if I see maloedema without a subcondylar insufficiency fracture and the sparing of malo at certain sites, I will put it as my osteoporosis or then any vascular necrosis and I will put the patient for follow-up. If we see subcondylar fracture, according to its direction and the extent of maloedema, we may say it is either osteonecrosis or subcondylar insufficiency fracture of the hip, similar to that of the hip. That's all. Thank you.